May he send you help from heaven and protect you. grant me your heart's desire to fulfill every one of your prayers. Brothers and sisters, a joy to be with you today as we celebrate this marriage, as we celebrate the love that Jordan and Abby share, and good for us to be together to pray for them, to support them, as they seal and strengthen this love in the sacrament of marriage. Our wedding day, Catholic wedding, we'll do our best to make it easy on you. Just keep your eye on the Catholics and stand where they stand and sit where they sit. Everything should be just fine. We begin in prayer, asking our Heavenly Father to bless this couple. Let us pray. Be attentive to our prayers, O Lord. In your kindness, pour out your grace on these, your servants, Jordan and Abby, that coming together before your altar, they may be confirmed in love for one another, through Christ our Lord. Please be seated for the liturgy of the Lord.
I'm reading from the book of Revelation. I, John, heard what sounded like the loud voice of a great multitude in heaven, saying, Alleluia! Salvation, glory, and might belong to our God. A voice coming from the throne said, Praise our God, all you his servants, and you revere him, small and great. Then I heard something like the sound of a great multitude, or the sound of rushing waters, or mighty peals of thunder, as they said, Alleluia. The Lord has established his reign. Our God, the Almighty. Let us rejoice and be glad, and give him glory. For the wedding day of the Lamb has come. His bride has made herself ready. She was allowed to wear a bright, clean linen garment. The linen represents the righteous deeds of the Holy One. Then the angel said to me, Righteous, blessed are those who have been called to the wedding feast of the Lamb. The word of the Lord.
Thank you.
A reading from the first letter of St. Paul to the Corinthians. Brothers and sisters, strive eagerly for the greatest spiritual gifts, but I shall show you still a more excellent way. If I speak in human and angelic tongues, but do not have love, I'm a resounding gong, clashing cymbal. If I have the gift of prophecy and comprehend all mysteries and all knowledge, if I have all faith so as to move mountains, but do not have love, I am nothing. If I give away everything I own, and if I hand my body over so that I may boast, but do not have love, I gain nothing. Love is patient. Love is kind. Love is not jealous. It is not pompous. It is not imprudent. It is not rude. It does not seek its own interests. It is not quick-tempered. It does not brood over injury. It does not rejoice over wrongdoing, but rejoices with the truth. It bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. Love never fails. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Lord be with you.
And
a reading from the Holy Gospel according to John. Jesus said to his disciples, "As the Father loves me, so I also love you. Remain in my love. If you keep my commandments, you will remain in my love, just as I have kept my Father's commandments and remain in his love. I have told you this so that my joy might be in you and your joy might be complete. This is my commandment. Love one another as I love you." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Please be seated. Meeting together, which I think was this week, Tuesday, when I asked what you were most looking forward to about getting married on that day, you told me that it was making it official, to officially begin your life together as husband and wife. And we're here today to make that happen. Right after all the meetings and retreats and marriage inventories, after tastings and fittings and rehearsals, we're here. Today you get to make it official. And all of us who are gathered here today rejoice that that is true, and we're happy to be here with you. The gospel you selected today, Jesus gives us one of the most beautiful and maybe one of the most challenging of his commandments when he says, "Love one another as I love you." It's the commandment that he gives to his disciples so shortly before he suffers his passion, one of the last things he says to his disciples. And he tells them to love one another as he has loved them, so that their joy might be complete. And if this is the case, then it's worth our time to just explore a little bit what it means to love as Jesus does, because complete joy sounds like a pretty good deal. And so how does Jesus love? To understand how Jesus loves, we need simply to look at the cross. Because on the cross, we see the greatest act of love that the world has ever known and ever will know. God himself laying down his life for us. As it turns out, that's what marriage is supposed to look like. Your love is to look like the cross. So now's your last chance to get out. So on the cross, we see this love to which you're called because it's this beautiful love. If we look at Jesus on the cross, we see a love that is free and total and faithful and fruitful. And this is the love that you're choosing today, a love that looks like the love of Jesus Christ crucified. The first thing we can say is that this love is free. We know that Jesus didn't have to die on the cross. He didn't have to lay down his life for the world, but he did. He chose to, and he did without expecting anything in return. He placed no conditions upon the gift of his love. He didn't say, I will do this if, or I will do this when. He freely laid down his life, knowing that he might not get anything in return. And today, that the love you are choosing is a love that is free. You're choosing today to love one another, not because you have to, or because you ought to, but because you want to. Remembering that every day love is a choice and not a feeling. Today you freely choose love. Another thing we notice when we look at the cross is that Christ's love is total. He could give nothing more than his entire life. He gave everything. He held nothing back. Today you choose to love with a love that is total. A love without reservation. A love that holds nothing back. You're choosing in a way to lay down your lives for one another, to give of yourselves to the other, completely and fully. And then when we look at the cross, we see that Christ's love is faithful. Even though throughout human history we turned away from the Lord, Jesus still chose to die for us. And even though we might still turn away from him, he will never turn away from us. He'll never withdraw his love. And today you're choosing to love with a love that is faithful. To love one another unconditionally and always, no matter how difficult the circumstances. You're choosing to love one another with the promise of never withdrawing your love. And then fourth, we see that Christ's love is fruitful. Through his act of love on the cross, Jesus offers us a share in new life. And today you're choosing to love with a love that is fruitful. And in one sense, this means that your love is meant to bring new life to the other, that you'll help one another flourish in all things, that your life will be better because of your love. In another sense, this means that your love is to bring new life into the world, through children, through little Adamses, and hopefully several of them. Your love for each other is to be so great that it can't be contained, but that new life should spring forth from it. And so today, by choosing to get married, you're choosing to love as Jesus loves, with a love that is free and total and faithful and fruitful. And based on what I know about you, based on what you've shared with me, you're off to a good start. You've shared that you actually, maybe not in these words, desire so many of these things. Share that you look forward to standing side by side with one another through life. This is a love that's faithful. You share that you look forward to growing together. This is a fruitfulness. And you share that you desire to start a family together. You share that you're better because of the other. And all of these are good signs, and all of these point to the beginnings of a joyful marriage. I have some advice for you, provided that you're willing to take marriage advice from a vow of celibate. And the marriage is this, the advice is this: remain in his love. Remain in his love. It tells us to remain in his love so that our joy might be complete. So what I have for you in advice is nothing new. Pray together. Worship together. This has been part of your homework since the very first day that we met. And this is homework that doesn't end today. Praying together and worshiping together are sure signs, sure ways for you to open yourself to the Lord's love. Ways that will help you remain in Him. So please be about those good works. I promise you that your marriage will be better if you pray together and worship together. You're getting married during the Easter season, and during the Easter season you didn't have a choice in your first reading, but I love that the first reading is what it is because it shows us what heaven is meant to be like. John the Evangelist tells us that heaven is a wedding feast. In fact, throughout sacred scripture, the one image that the Lord reveals most often about his love for us is the love of marriage. And so we know that in addition to our joy today, the Lord rejoices that you're here. And I encourage you to take comfort in that, to be confident in that, that the Lord blesses what's happening. Now, if you're ready to enter that love, if you're ready to make it official, I think we should do that. And so please join me in your party at the front of the altar, and we can get you married. Jordan, you have come together into the house of the church so that in the presence of the church's minister and the community, your intention to enter into marriage may be strengthened by the Lord and the sacred seal. Christ abundantly blesses the love that binds you. Through a special sacrament, he enriches and strengthens those he has already consecrated by holy baptism, that they may be faithful to each other forever and assume all the responsibilities of married life. And so in the presence of the church, I ask you to state your intentions. Abby and Jordan, have you come here to enter into marriage without coercion, freely and wholeheartedly? Are you prepared as you follow the path of marriage to love and honor each other for as long as you both shall live? Are you prepared to accept children lovingly from God and to bring them up according to the law of Christ and his church? Since it is your intention to enter the covenant of holy matrimony, join your right hands and declare your consent before God in this church. I, Jordan, take you, Abby, to be my wife. I promise to be faithful to you in good times and in bad, in sickness and in health, to love you and to honor you all the days of my life. I, Abby, take you, Jordan, to be my husband. Thank you. Jordan, receive this ring. As a sign of my love and prayer. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. So, is the little guy really carrying his ring? Awesome. And so now you are married, we want to support you with our prayers. Our brothers and sisters, I would ask for you to stand as we pray for this newly married couple. We ask that God, who has been pleased to crown and consecrate the love of Abby and Jordan, will now strengthen and seal them with his grace.
That Jordan and Abby now join in marriage, may grow in holiness and happiness, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That God will bless their covenant, just as he chose to sanctify marriage at Cana in Galilee, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That Jordan and Abby will be granted faithful and fruitful love, joy-filled peace, and the courage to bear witness to Jesus Christ in their marriage and in their lives, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That we may grow in virtue day by day, and that those who are burdened may receive the help and consolation of God's grace, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That the grace of the sacrament of marriage will be renewed by the Holy Spirit in all married persons here present, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all members of our families who have passed from this world, that they may enter swiftly into the great feast of the Lamb with all the saints and angels in heavenly glory, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Now let us humbly invoke God's blessing upon this bride and groom, that in his kindness he may favor with his help those on whom he has bestowed the sacrament of matrimony. O God, who by your mighty power created all things out of nothing, and when you had set in place the beginnings of the universe, formed man and woman in your own image, making the woman an inseparable helpmate to the man, that they might no longer be two but one flesh, and taught that what you were pleased to make one must never be divided. O God, who consecrated the bond of marriage by so great a mystery that in the wedding covenant you foreshadowed the sacrament of Christ in his church. O God, by whom woman is joined to man, and the companionship they had at the beginning is endowed with the one blessing, not forfeited by original sin nor washed away by the flood. Look now with favor on these your servants joined together in marriage, who ask to be strengthened by your blessing. Send down on them the grace of the Holy Spirit, and pour your love into their hearts, that they may remain faithful in the marriage covenant. May the grace of love and peace abide in your daughter Abby, and let her always follow the example of those holy women whose praises are sung in the scriptures. May her husband entrust his heart to her, so that acknowledging her as his equal and his joint heir to the life of grace, he may show her due honor and cherish her always with the love that Christ has for his church. And now, Lord, we implore you, may these your servants hold fast to the faith and keep your commandments, made one in the flesh, may they be blameless in all they do, and with the strength that comes from the gospel, may they bear true witnesses to Christ before all. May they be blessed with children, and prove themselves virtuous parents who live to see their children's children. And grant that, reaching at last together the fullness of years for which they hope, they may come to the life of the blessed in the kingdom of heaven, through Christ our Lord. Amen. And now let us pray together as Christ our Savior taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. So just a couple of brief notes before we conclude our time together. After the couple and Hardy process out, Abby and Jordan will be happy to receive you in the gathering space. And then a reminder that the reception begins at 5 o'clock. And then one more reminder, I need to see the four of you to make it official with the government. Okay. So we will have a solemn blessing here, three short prayers followed by amen, and then we'll have you loose. The Lord be with you. Bow down for the blessing. May God, the eternal Father, keep you of one heart in love for one another, that the peace of Christ may dwell in you and abide always in your home. Amen. May you be blessed in your children, have solace in your friends, and enjoy true peace with everyone. Amen. May you be witnesses in the world to God's charity, so that the afflicted and needy who have known your kindness may one day receive you thankfully into the eternal dwelling of God. Amen. And may the blessing of Almighty God, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit come down on you and remain with you forever. Go in peace. Thanks be to God. And I'm pleased to present for the first time Mr. and Mrs. Adams.